Father, we thank you this morning. What a blessing. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your power. We thank you for your victory. Bless us. Bless our heart as we approach into your way. We thank you for all people who are watching us on online. People who are in this place right now. We thank you for their life. That through your word, let there be a testimony. Let there be a deliverance.
Amen.
Let there be a touch. Let there be a way out in your life.
Amen.
For out of your word, proceed light. Bless us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we may be seated. God bless you this moment, wherever you're watching us from. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest over your life. And as you are joining us today, your life will never be the same. For in the house of the Lord, there is victory and there is blessing. For the other day, the psalmist said that I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Because once you are in the house of the Lord, there is something that you get. And you can never get it out there. It is always being found in the house of the Lord. And I believe that there is something that is coming on your way. That how to develop a good attitude. Or how to become a good attitude. So this moment, may God bless you as you have joined us.
Amen.
And I believe that as you are with us, you will be blessed in this hour ahead of us. For a few months, weeks now, we've been establishing about an attitude. And we've explained much to you that attitude is very, very important. Because it is everything about you. Your attitude can bless you or it can destroy you. Your attitude is the eye of your future. So how far you want to go determines your attitude. And people have studied and have learned a lot about the topic called attitude. And this morning, I want to talk to you about a way out or how to develop a good attitude. And I explained to you that there are four types of attitude. We have the good attitude, the bad attitude, or negative attitude. Not really bad attitude, but negative attitude. We have positive attitude.
Yes.
And a good and then negative attitude. Then we have neutral attitude and we have second attitude.
Yes.
We establish a fact that it is only one that can make you fulfill your destiny. And that is good attitude or positive attitude. You can replace the positive as good. It is the only one that can help you in life. If you have a negative attitude, you can't do much in life. If you have a neutral attitude, which they are all on my page, you can watch it, you can go to YouTube, you will see all the types of attitude. This attitude that we are talking about has destroyed a lot of people. They are in church, they are clapping their hands, they are paying their tithes, but they don't know why their finances is not going well. They don't know why their relationship is not working. They don't know why their marriages are not working. They don't know why their life is some way. And God opened my eyes to see that there is a small word called attitude. That you may be paying your tithe, but if your attitude is not genuinely, if your attitude is not correct, if your attitude is not accurate, if your attitude is not positive, if your attitude is not good, you can't go far. So, I want to establish how to become a good attitude person. Since negative attitude person is not good, negative attitude character is not good, neutral attitude character is not good, and seeking attitude character is not good. Because we explained to you that somebody who has a negative attitude always gets angry. He gets angry without a cause. And then he's always doubtful. He doubts about his or her life. And then he's always frustrated. Frustration is a mother of every failure. So once to have a negative attitude, you're always frustrated, you're always doubtful, and you are always angry without a cause. So it's not good. And you yourself know that it's not good. And a neutral attitude is somebody who is not talking about anything. He's not doubtful. He's a neutral person. For him, if you can help him, he can become a positive person. We establish a fact that one of the attitudes of a neutral person is always silence. And the silence is the best response to a fool. Which I didn't want to say it last week. Silence is the best response to a fool. So neutral attitude people, they are always silent. And God is going to help us.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
There's that thing that is bubbling in my heart. One of the things about neutral people, they are always silent. And silence is the response to a fool. So since all these things is not good, we are trying to bring the best out of you so that you can become a positive attitude person. Second attitude, we explain that it is an attitude that offends the moral. The moral is a standard or the rules or laws that has been patterned for our life. But these second people, they try to offend the moral, the pattern or the way to life. They try to offend it in a sense that they revolt and scandalize and outrage, and then they bring shock. So when there is a standard that don't kill, second attitude person will kill. So they will bring a shock. They bring a shock. So that is second attitude, and it's not good. If you're like that, it's not good. It will not help you. There are very dangerous people in life, and they always fight against anything that is positive. Second attitude person always they have in mind that they will fight against anything that offend or that will turn the positive attitude upside down. And all these things is not good. So today, I want to talk to you about how to develop a good attitude. And what did we say about good attitude? Good attitude or positive attitude, they bring strength, they bring energy, they bring motivation, and they bring initiative, ideas, plans. This is a positive attitude. So how do it means that in your locality, in your business, in your ministry, in your marriage, in your academics, you should be able to bring strength. That wherever you go, if there is somebody who is weak, once you leave there is strength. It means that you don't go and cause more problem. You don't go and cause more harm. But you go and then you produce strength. So we are talking to you about how to develop a positive attitude, because positive attitude, they are energetic. That when they reach a place and the people are not energized, once a positive attitude person comes there, he brings energy. It is like he brings revival, he brings an awakening. So how to develop a positive attitude is what we are talking about today. How to bring strength in your marriage, how to bring strength in your relationship, how to bring strength in the working place where you are working. Not how to let the work go down, or how to destroy, or how to scatter, or how to backbite, but how to bring strength to your community. How to bring motivation to your community. That if people are giving up in life, you come there and you motivate them and you try to tell them that they can make it, they can do it. Let's
just read some scriptures, then we'll begin to move into the word. We'll begin to move on. In Romans chapter 7. Thank you, Lord. Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7, verse 15. Let's read a couple of scriptures, then we will see what we can do. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that I do not. But what I hate, that I do. Because we are trying to how to establish it. Because you can't be energetic if you are not taught. It doesn't come by osmosis. Energetic doesn't come by osmosis. Energy doesn't come by osmosis. Strength doesn't come by osmosis. Motivation doesn't come by osmosis. Initiative doesn't come by osmosis. So you must be taught how to develop a positive attitude. How to develop it. Because Apostle Paul was saying here, he said that, for that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that I do. 16. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that is the one I do. Now, if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. Ephesians chapter 4. Thank you, Lord. Ephesians chapter 4. Verse 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. But that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearer. Did you hear that?
Yes.
Let no corrupt communication. Let me change the give you another translation. It says that do not use foul or abusive language. Let everything you say be good and helpful, so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. So it's not easy. That is what it says, that do not use abusive words. Another word is foul. Another word is corrupt. It because that is us. That is the way we were created. And that is the way we were made. So it is inside us. We were born in it. That words that comes out of us. Because how did we describe an attitude? An attitude is an outward expression. And it is something that is within. So what comes out of you makes us know the type of attitude you portray. So we are trying to establish a point that it is not easy to have a good attitude. So you have to learn it, or you have to develop it. And if you can't develop it, you can never become good. Yes. Another translation says that which watch the way you talk. Let nothing foul or dirty come out of your mouth. Say only what helps. Eat well and give it. So with this, you could see that it's not easy. Because to watch means that you have to be very careful. And we lie down with the things
That is not good. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 12 says that from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. Ladies and gentlemen, these three scriptures I've read to you shows that there is something in us that makes us change our attitude. There is something in us that makes us do things which are not lawful. There is something in us that makes us to respond to things. There are things that is within that makes us respond outwardly. And these things are negative attitude, neutral attitude, and secret attitude. So, for you to possess a positive attitude, you must learn. If you can't learn, you cannot graduate. If you can't learn, you will always be negative, you will always be neutral, you will always be secret, and you can never amount to anything that you want to do in life. So, somebody may say, how do I go about it? I have something that I've put it down that I'm going to explore to you. That number one, you have to recognize the power of attitude. Okay. Recognize the power of attitude. Ladies and gentlemen, attitude has power. There's power in attitude. Overlook things. Don't ignore things. Be conscious of the power of attitude. Whether it's negative attitude, whether it's positive attitude, whether it is neutral attitude, whether it is secret attitude, these things have power. It means that you can be influenced. So you have to recognize, get understanding. But we say that in all your getting, get wisdom and get understanding. You may be in marriage, get understanding about attitude. You may be in relationship, get understanding about attitude. You may be in academics, get understanding about attitude. You must recognize that there is power of about attitude. If you meet somebody who is negative and you don't recognize it, you can be influenced with his negativity. If you meet somebody who has a neutral attitude, you can be influenced by the neutral attitude person. If you meet somebody who has a secret attitude, you can be influenced. Therefore, recognize the power of attitude. One of the best examples is somebody can say that, I think I'm going to die. Where did he get it from? His neighbor. He heard it from people. For him, he has a positive attitude. But because he does not recognize the power of attitude, somebody just whispered to you, I think I'm not loved. Then you also, few minutes, few moments, few months, that those words also start to come. Because you cannot, you don't know that there is power in attitude. Before you were very lovely, you entered into that job, and then the attitude of somebody who is an angry attitude, the person showed it to you, and then unconsciously you're also doing what the same thing as the person is doing. That is what I'm saying, that recognize the power of attitude. That then Jesus was speaking to his disciples and said that beware of the living. Beware of the living. It means that get understanding about them. Don't just ignore things. There is something called attitude which carries power. And that is what I took time to explain to you all these weeks. That positive attitude, negative attitude, neutral attitude, and secret attitude. So number one, you have to recognize. If you can't recognize it, you will not know that this attitude is making your boss to sack you. This attitude is making your husband to leave you. This attitude is making your wife to leave you. You can't know. You won't know because you have failed to recognize the power of attitude. Number two, be sensitive
When you approach in any situation, be sensitive. Once you get the power, or once you begin to know the power about the attitude, then you develop a sensuous character that any approach, any situation, any area you appear, you have to be sensitive that this attitude, either one of them, can come out of you. Whether positive, whether negative, whether neutral, whether seeker, it can come out of you. So in a meeting, be sensitive. In your marriage, be sensitive. Once you begin to recognize the power of attitude, then you have to be sensitive. Your sensitivity, your signal must be alert so that you will never make a mistake.
Try to help you out to develop. Because at times some people will be in a place, they are not sensitive. So they just fall into the trap. It could be a trap. A question could be a trap. But because you are not sensitive, a call could be a trap. An invitation could be a trap. But because you are not sensitive, you fall away. So if you want to develop a good attitude, then be sensitive when you approach in any situation. Number three, if you want to develop a good attitude, one of the things that can help you is to give yourself, or is to give to the Holy Spirit assistance. If you want to develop your character, your attitude, not character, there's a difference between attitude and character. Somebody was asking me, what's the difference? And we are trying our best to come on your way. There is something. Attitude is different from character. Character is who you are, and attitude is what you do. Character is who you are, and attitude is what you do. So at times, what you do is not your character, but we try to interchange it. And that is why I took time to explain to you about character. When I begin to go into character, you will see that it's similar, but it's something different altogether. But if you can get the understanding of character and get understanding of attitude, you become a bomb into any situation that comes on your way. So give to the assistance of the Holy Spirit. In Luke chapter 12. Let's see something. In Luke chapter 12. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Luke chapter 12, verse 11. Thank you, Lord. And when they bring you unto the synagogues and unto magistrates and powers, take ye no thought how or what thing you shall answer or what you shall say. Verse 12. For the Holy Ghost shall teach you in the same hour what you ought to say. When you are being called, when you are in a conversation, when you are in an argument, when you are in a class, when you are in front of magistrates, when you are in front of lawyers, when you are in front of bankers, when you are in front of people, one of the things you can do is to give yourself into the assistance of the Holy Spirit. Apostle Paul said that nothing good is in me. It means that there is somebody who can help you. And that is what Jesus Christ came to do. He gave us the assistance of the Holy Spirit. So one of the things I do is I always seek assistance from the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, as I'm going, if you don't speak, I can't speak. Holy Spirit, as I'm talking, if you don't talk, I can't talk. Because within me, there is nothing good. My response will be negative. My response will be neutral. My response will be seeking. Therefore, Holy Spirit, I cleave unto you. I yield unto you. I need the assistance of the Holy Ghost. If not, I can make a mistake. So if you want to develop it for you, it's not easy.
where you were born, and how you were born, and how you were raised, and when you were raised, and the things you have done, and what you are still doing, there is nothing good in you. The only person who can help you is the assistance, the Holy Spirit. And this is what many people have missed it. Assistance of the Holy Spirit. He is in church. God has given us assistance. Somebody to assist us. Somebody to help us. In fact, the Greek word is parakletos. That is a helper. A helper. Somebody who will talk for you. Somebody who will help you. Somebody who will say this, do this. That is the power of the Holy Ghost. So if you want to develop it, one of the best prayer I pray in the Holy Spirit. Luke chapter 11 says that if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more your heavenly Father will not give the Holy Ghost to them who ask for it. One of my best prayers I pray every day. Holy Spirit, come into me. Holy Spirit, walk with me. Holy Spirit, sit down with me. Holy Spirit, talk to me. Holy Spirit, sleep with me. Holy Spirit, one of my best prayers is about the Holy Spirit. I can spend 1 hour and pray for the Holy Spirit. I need him in my life. So far as I'm concerned, where I was born, how I was born, and where I come from, nothing good. So some people are trying to develop their character, their attitude. Without the assistance of the Holy Spirit, you fail. And that is why, let me remind you, that is why you always go and come back and say, I did my best. I tried my best. You can't do so. Your best is negative. That is why Bible says that the good things you are doing is like a filthy garment. I did my best. I tried my best. I did everything. No. So far as you are concerned, there is nothing good in you. But once you cling to the Holy Spirit, hey, the Spirit of the Lord in the life of man, something wrong. The Spirit of the Lord in the life of man, something wrong. Something wrong. And disposition, and this Holy Spirit liveth inside us. He tells us what to say. He tells us where to go. He changes our atmosphere. He changes our outward experience. It's not the Holy Spirit. He's inside us. He's inside us. He's inside us. Something more than gold.
Listen.
wisdom that he carried that men don't have. There is an intelligence he carries that men don't have. And that person who carries is in the Holy Spirit. He dwelleth inside us. And if we can call him for assistance,
we'll help you. You help you.
Number four.
We are going, so we have to do it fast.
Holy Spirit, I can pause here and finish the service. But I'm trying to tell how to develop it. Anything outside the Holy Spirit, you are prone to err. You are prone to fall down. You are prone to backslide. You are prone to err. Anything outside the assistance of the Holy Spirit.
Number four.
Be addicted to the inspiration of the Bible.
Hallelujah.
Be addicted to the inspiration of the Bible. What is inspiration? It is the process of being mentally stimulated. That's all. That's the meaning of inspiration. So you have to be addicted into the inspiration of the Bible. Why? Because in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and 16, Bible says that all scriptures are God's breath.
Yes.
Everything is it is God's. It is God stimulating everything. That the Bible is the stimulation of God. It is God breathing inside people to write it. So if you want to know how to develop it, then the best place to go for it is the book that God has given to us.
Yes.
I am so glad that Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me.
Why you can be wise in the Holy Scriptures is because All scriptures is given by inspiration of God. And it is profitable for doctrine. What is doctrine? Doctrine is a standard of things that you do. It's a doctrine. Something you do continuously. Something you believe. So once you begin to make Bible, be addicted to Bible, it convicts you that you have to develop a positive attitude, and it becomes a doctrine that you've been indoctrinated into a positive attitude person, and don't you have a doctorate degree of a positive attitude person. So it's a doctrine. You establish it, and it becomes yours. You see, it's for reproof. To reproof is to rebuke. So you will know that being negative is not good. You will know that being neutral is not good. So the Holy Scripture will rebuke you and tell you that you should have thought this way. You should have dressed this way. You should have done this way. You should have. That the Holy Scriptures will rebuke you. And it is good for correction. One day somebody came into my house. The person was an unbeliever. We sat down, we talked a little. He took a cigarette. Say, hey, in my house, you don't smoke. Put the cigarette inside where you took it from. When you go, you begin to smoke. The person was shaking. The person thought I was joking. I said, you come, there is a doctrine in my house.
Yes.
There is a doctrine in my house that you can't smoke cigarette. So go away with your cigarette. Correction. Reproof. So once you become addicted to the word of God, he says that all scripture is given in God's breath, expression, is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, to rebuke, for correction. You correct this, and then for instruction in righteousness, that a man of God may be perfect. So when we are talking of a positive attitude, we are talking of someone who can bring perfection. How can you become perfect unless you become addicted to gospel? 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 19 says that we have also more sure way of prophecy. Whereunto you do well that you take heed. That is a sure way of prophecy. That is a sure way of God's language. That is a sure way of God's book. That you have to do well. It means that take heed, do well, and then get understanding. Do well and take it. You have to try your best and look into it. Try your best and watch inside. Try your best and embrace it. Be addicted to God's way. Why? He says that
dark.
You see them and then you say, ah, the secret is, he failed to go into the scripture. That will bring him to develop. That will bring him to rise up. That will bring him. It will be like a light that shines in a dark place. They say my family. They say my background. They say I come from. They say I am this. Once you go for the word of God, it doesn't matter your background. Yeah. I will say that Jesus has bought us with his precious blood from different tribes, different nations, different languages, and he has gathered us. He has translated us from the kingdom of darkness, and he has brought us into his marvelous light. The word. The word. We have many people who are in church without the word. And that is why they are in church without the word, and their life is in way. The world is dictating their life for them. Social media is dictating their life for them. Social media is telling them how to marry. Social media is telling them how to dress. Social media is telling them how to speak. But there is a word in the word of God. There is a word in the word of God that makes you light in the place of darkness. We live in a dark world. Communities are falling. Countries are falling. Nations are falling. Because there is a dark system. In the midst of your company, in the midst of your factory, you become a light. They look at you and they say, who born you? Then you tell them that there is a father who is called the father of the spirit. He dwelleth inside me. He has made me like this. He has changed my life. In your dark environment, in your dark marriage, your husband will look at you and say that, how did you make it? Then you say that there is a father who is not my biological father, but he has adopted me. His name is Ayanda Dayama. He dwells inside me. We call him the father of all spirits.
Amen.
Show it. Until the day done. And the day start. For the way, you become what God wants you to become. Yeah. If you go for the way, you'll be anointed the way God wants you to become. Yeah. If you go for the way, it will change your life. If you go for the way, it is what it is. Yeah. The word of God is so sure. There is a sure word of prophecy. Even though I come from a background where nobody prosper, but there is prosperity in the word of God. Yeah. Even though I come from a background that nobody succeed, but there is success in the word of God.
Yeah.
You are not reading them. You are not addicted. I don't want to say read your addicted is not everybody can read. So once you become addicted, you can put your Bible, you can hear it while somebody is preaching to you, while somebody is reading. We have it, we have system how to be addicted to the Holy Spirit.
Whatever, the life couldn't succeed well, he just did some calls
fall. But we say, but that's the plan of our papa. They will continue to fall. They will continue to stumble. Why?
Because we have refused to go for the way. Number five.
The phone down, and then you begin to call the person and say, what did you say?
so busy. The manager is in a meeting somewhere, he's so busy. Your husband is somewhere, just gave you an instruction because you couldn't note it down. And the person will come up. I fear, Akusha, I told you. Yeah, when you said it, I tried to call, but your line was off because I didn't understand it well. And that's why many things have fallen apart. Why? Because they don't develop attentiveness in listening. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be set to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Lay aside every filthiness, every naughtiness, and receive the meekness, the engrafted way, which is able to save your soul. But be ye doers of the way, and not hearers only, deceiving your own self. Are you understanding? Yeah. I understand. But you know that you don't understand. Bible says that you deceive your own self. For if any be a hearer of the way and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. That is what we do. As we are coming this morning, look at yourself in the mirror, you change yourself, you look like this, then you begin to. Bible says you are the same thing. As you are going, you forget what you look like in the mirror. So many people, because they don't pay attention, they cannot be. Because you can only do when you pay attention. You can't do if you don't pay attention. So it seems that don't be only the hearer. It means that don't listen. But don't listen alone, but be attentive. Because once you become attentive, you do. Many people are listeners, but they are not doers. Why? Because they are not attentive in listening. They only listen, but they don't do. Why? Because they don't pay attention. They are not attentive people. And that is what has brought many things down. He is in church, all right. He dances, he sings, all right. But what is bringing him down is he is not able to do. Why? Because he's not paying attention to what he's doing. Bible says that, for he beholded himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetted what manner of man he was. But whose looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continued therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the way, this man shall be.